silence for a moment. I'd just like to say a few words about John Evans. But first of all, can I just thank Alan and Preservation Jazz Society for putting on tonight's gig. Also to say about the Preservation Jazz Society that if it wasn't for organisations like that, jazz in Britain would be pretty well short-served. It's people like Alan just volunteering all their efforts week in, week out. And no one ever says thank you, so I think it's time you can say thanks to Alan. And also a big thanks to Dick Williams and the band for playing tonight. Especially to Dick. I haven't seen Dick for many years. We used to work together in London, had some marvellous times, so it's great to catch up and play with Paul and Jeff and Mike as well.
Yeah.
Who?
Yes.
Anyway, a few words about John. When I moved up to London in 1980, John was extremely helpful to me, and that's to put it, that must be the understatement of my life. He was absolutely superb. But you've probably seen Alan's done a leaflet about John's background. I haven't got my reading glasses on, so I can't give you the dates. You're going to give me your... I'll tell you what, I'll put my reading glasses on. Could you just turn your heads to one side? I'd rather do this in private, you understand.
Putting his teeth in.
the dog's got them for a day, it's his turn.
Help him out, somebody.
Who'd have thought it?
Exactly. Who'd have thought it? All of you are going to
Thanks very much. It's, as you get older, it just becomes harder, doesn't it? And every time you go to the optician, there's that sharp intake of breath, and the lenses get bigger and heavier. Last time I suggested, why can't I just use a couple of marmalade jar bottoms of marmalade jars? And, well, that didn't go down too well. But John, born in Cardiff in July 21st, 1934. Started playing the clarinet, and John Hummerstone wrote to me because Emma had said his friends used to come round and practice. When their neighbour, Mr. Rogers, couldn't take any more, he would tap on the living room window, and that was a sign to stop.
It was.
And John Hummerstone was there for that occasion. I have to say, in these frightful times of modernity, that wouldn't happen. There'd probably be a mass riot or something, and you'd have been singing rap, John. Or some other such urban boom. Then John did national service in the RAF, and he played in the Fighter Command Band. I have to say that was news to me, because all the years I knew John, he kept pretty quiet about that. I don't know why, I think it's perhaps the Fighter Command Band, and I was going to say, let's play the theme from Dam Busters or something. And then he went on to the Guildhall School of Music, studied and worked as a professional musician. He worked with lots of bands, including Freddie Randall, Mick Mulligan, George Melly, Lynn Saunders, who's with his banjo, will be coming up in a minute, and also back cabaret entertainers such as Clinton Ford. And then he was with I Can't Talk and Turn the Page at the Same Time. It's another thing. It's a bit like George Bush trying to chew gum and walk at the same time. And then in 1957 he met Jean, and they used to live in a flat in Earl's Court. I thought you'd like to know that, just because Earl's Court was a pretty seedy area in those times. And they shared it with Ray Worley, who was a terrific saxophone player who unfortunately passed away a few months ago, and a pile of other musicians. And that was actually in Sinclair Road. And John and Jean, they got married in 61, and Sean was born in 64, and Gemma, who's over there. I'm sorry, Gemma, but your name is going to, your age is going to be released. Was born in 1967.
Young!
I can see pocket calculators are quickly pulled out and trying to work all that out. And anyway, to support his family, he became an English lecturer at Southgate College. And John always used to, he couldn't stand it. John used to say to me, we'd be going to the car in a gig, and John would be saying, God, he said, it's hell, he said, dealing with these people, he said, it's not so much they're thick or stupid. He said, I'm trying to teach them communications, which they'll need in their business life. They're not interested, dear boy, they're not interested, one bit. And he used to fulminate all the way to the gig, and then a few drinks later, it all calmed down. But he used to call, he used to say, yes, tomorrow morning I've got meat three. That was butcher's apprenticeships. And then he'd have, and the next day is, oh God, I've got the worst of the lot, woodwork four, whatever that was. I think that was all carpentry apprentices. And so he went on. So when he finally retired, he was, I got a bit of a retirement, he was extremely glad to get out of it. And then he was just working as a professional musician, jobbing musician, playing all over the place in London with people like, I'm looking in there, Mike Nash, myself, Max Britton, Dick Williams, Anglo-Welsh All-Stars, Bob Guthrie's band. Bob Guthrie was a complete, absolute character. And when John and I were in the band with Mike Nash, Bob Guthrie was a small guy, and he was made a pile of money selling concrete pumps to Arabs. I've never quite worked that out. I mean, I know they've got plenty of sand in Arabia, so probably accounts for it. And we used to work with Bob Guthrie and occasionally with Mickey Cook, the trombone player. And Bob always used to have these catchphrases that John and I used to sit there cringing. He used to go to the crowd, just a bit of fun, just a bit of fun. Oh, God. John especially, he'd always go, oh Christ, I can't stand it. And Mickey Cook used to stand behind him. When he was saying just a bit of fun, he used to do a marvellous take on Sooty and Sweep. And he used to say, now Sooty, tell the boys and girls how they're going, just have just a bit of fun. And all that sort of stuff. But anyway, that was John. He had a terrific life, and he was a great friend and comrade. And I think the most important thing for me about John was his clarinet playing. I think the art of jazz is to be an individual voice, is to have your own language, your own vocabulary, and to actually sound like someone different. Now, I know John was extremely fond of Benny Goodman, Artie Shaw, and all the great clarinet players, but John always sounded to me like John Evans. Instantly recognizable as John Evans. Yeah. His whole attack, his ideas, the way he phrased his phrasing and his tunes and his licks, as they call them. And it was always, I could hear him anyway and go, that's John. And to me, that was absolutely terrific. And that was, I think, the hallmark of John's excellence. He also, I have to say, was. Didn't run on a short fuse, but he was not one of life's great consolidators, or he wouldn't really meet people halfway. And you'd be having a sort of discussion, I don't know, like politics or something. And instead of agreeing to disagree or coming to some sort of amicable conclusion, he always used to end the discussion by going, I'll tell you what, they're just a bunch of Anglo-Saxon expletives. And that was it. If you want to know what the expletive is, you need to look up the Oxford Dictionary of English Slang, the new version which has just come out, and I think the start of the Cockney rhyming slang is Jeremy. You can work that one out for yourselves. Finally, I've put together a memorial album of a pile of recordings that John and I did with a lot of musicians over the years. And that'll be coming out probably about a couple of months' time. It'll be sold at cost, so it'll be quite reasonable. I'm just getting 100 copies though, that's all. But it's just something to remember John by, and also all the musicians who play with him. So that'll be out in a couple of months. I'll keep you posted on that one. So really, I think we just need to raise our glasses to John Evans, and also to absent friends, to people who, for whatever reason, can't be with us tonight. So, John Evans.
John Evans.
Rest in peace. Thanks very much. We're now going to welcome up Tim Wacher, and Lynn Saunders is somewhere here.
Taking photographs.
And should we do? Okay, we're going to do one before a break. One before a break, and this one is a very beautiful Fats Waller tune called Blue Turning Grey Over You.
You're going to use this one?
Yeah, that's fine.
Yeah, hold
on.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.